Good morning, students. Welcome to your history video lecture. Now, in today's class, we'll begin with the last topic of this chapter, and it is totally dealing with Mahabharat and how historians handle Mahabharat as a historical source. Now, this entire section we'll be covering under two video lectures. So, let's begin with the topic: handling texts, historians and the Mahabharat. So how do historians handle the textual material which usually in the form of manuscript is available to them, or they might get it in bits and pieces or in fragments, and some of these fragments or manuscripts have survived? So how do historians end up retrieving any kind of valuable information from these texts? We'll be looking into that. So while analyzing these texts, historians pay very close attention to certain details. Now let us look what are these details. The first one is the language which is used in this text. So it is through this language that historians are able to comment or observe whether it was a highly technical language such as Sanskrit, used for and by only the Brahmins who were educated in it, or it was a local language such as Pali, Tamil or Prakrit, used for and by the common people living in that era. Next, they move forward to analyze what kind of text that particular textual material is. Whether it is purely in the form of a ritualistic text such as that of the Vedas. Okay, Vedas are mostly for carrying out rituals and they are mostly in the form of mantras. So historians see whether the text is in the form of rituals or it is in the form of a format of a story being told, just like the story of Mahabharat. Next, the historians move to understand the five W's that are associated with their task. Let us look into what are these five W's. The first one is, the historians try to answer the question, who wrote the text, so that they'll be able to get familiar with the perspective of the person who wrote it. Okay, so the first W is who. Then we come to the next part, that is, for whom was the text written? Okay, who were the target audience that was supposed to gain something from the text which was written during that particular era? Okay, hum log target audience nahi hai, target audience of that time, of the ancient era, whichever period in which the text was written, who was the target audience? For example, if we look into Dharm Shastras, the target audience was supposed to be, it was written by the Brahmins and for the Brahmins, as well as all the other Varnas of society, which formed a Brahminical society. Then we come to the next W, that is, when was this textual material composed or compiled? Okay, they try to look into the time period in order to chronologically arrange and study it. Then the historians look to answer the next W, that is, where was this textual material composed? That is, they seek the answer to the place where this text might have been composed. So only after making the preliminary investigation of these questions, that is, who wrote it, for whom it was written, when was it written, and where was it written, do historians finally move to the last part of their assessment. So finally, the historians end up reading the content of the text. Okay, what is written in it? Okay, they try to answer the question, what is written in it? So that text actually helps them to arrive at a conclusion. Okay, and this conclusion is what will make that text historically significant. Now we'll be exclusively dealing with the language and content of Mahabharat. Okay, the original Mahabharat, first of all, was written in Sanskrit language. We have already studied this when we were doing the introductory part of the chapter. So the Sanskrit used in Mahabharat is relatively easier than what was used in Vedas. The Vedic Sanskrit is much more tough to understand and comprehend from a common man's perspective. Anyway, the Mahabharat, the original Mahabharat written in Sanskrit, was written in a simple Sanskrit, which was most probably widely understood by the people of that time. That is why this Sanskrit Mahabharat was produced in different languages later on, and many more stories were further incorporated within it. Okay, as a part of compromise between local tradition and the dominant tradition. Okay, thoda sa recap karne ka koshish hai. We have already done this in the last classes. So now, when the historians have to understand the content of the Mahabharat, how do they go about doing this? So they classify the contents of the Mahabharat under two headings. One is called the narrative section and the other is called didactic section. Okay, the narrative section, as it might be clear from the word, is derived from the word narration. Or generally hum log kya narrate karte hain? Stories. So certain section within Mahabharat are purely talking about the stories. In fact, the central theme or the narrative or narration of Mahabharat is about a set of two warring cousins and how that resulted in the Mahabharat war. So definitely there are prominent narrative sections available in Mahabharat. Next, we come to the didactic section. So didactic section is supposed to represent the prescriptions for social behavior. That means the behavior that was supposed to be followed by different groups within a society so that everything existed in a balanced or an equilibrium state. So these didactic section were supposed to be more in the form of upadesh, jisko bolte hain. Theek hai? So सोसाइटी में ज़्यादा उथल पुथल ना हो, दैट इज़ वाई दीज सेक्शंस वर एडेड विद इन द महाभारत. नाउ द मोस्ट फेमस एग्जाम्पल ऑफ द डायडैक्टिक पोर्शन और सेक्शन मेंशन्ड इन महाभारत इज़ दैट ऑफ भगवद गीता. द भगवद गीता इज़ ऑल्सो कॉल्ड द सॉन्ग ऑफ गॉड, दैट इज़ द लिटरल ट्रांसलेशन ऑफ इट. सो दिस Bhagavad Gita forms a climax of the Mahabharat. Okay, this is the section where Arjun, okay, the warrior Arjun, the Pandav, he was hesitant to carry out his duties, you know, fearing all the annihilation that the war would bring. He was hesitant to kill his own family members, kyunki war mein uske opposite kaun the, uske cousins hi the. And so many other important people in their life, such as Guru Dronacharya or Bhishma Pitama, were all standing on the opposite side. Okay, so wo tha na haath kaap jata tha. So this is what happened. So in this Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna, okay, he advises Arjun on his duties, okay? And there is a very famous line from Mahabharata which Lord Krishna quotes is that, karm kiye ja, phal ki chinta mat kar, okay? So all these famous quotations and sayings that you might be familiar with are taken from the portion of or the conversation between between Krishna and Arjun, where Lord Krishna is instructing or laying down the norms of behavior that was supposed to be followed by everyone. So Mahabharat is also called Itihas, which when we translate it into English, it directly means history. So now the historians are of divided opinion. There are differences in opinion, where certain historians think that this conflict or Mahabharat war did actually take place, okay, at some point of time, and this was preserved in the Mahabharat narrative, okay. However, there are some other historians who say that there is not enough evidence to support the fact that this war happened for real. That is why there is a differences of opinion amongst historians. So this is it for today. Kindly go through your text and you'll be getting assignments. Do it on time.